Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Look, this is our first presentation in front of a live audience in over 2 years. I expect a little more enthusiasm. All right, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
There we go. I'm so excited to be in a three-dimensional session for the first time in 21 months. My name is Bob Morrison, and I am the director of the Center for Social Emotional Learning and Arts Education, and it's really our pleasure to be here with this fantastic session for you today. Before we get started, I just want to recognize our sponsors. Con Selmer has been generous in supporting this particular event, the good folks at GIA who printed the handouts that you all have here, as well as Save the Music for some of the content, and our good friends at Music for All. Additionally, there is a QR code that we have here for you. So if you want to scan it real quick, we'll also bring it up a couple more times during the session. We have created, wow, look at that shot. We have created a special Google Drive that has all of the resources that we're going to be talking about today and a lot of things that we won't talk about today, but will be of assistance for you in your own programs. Now, for those of you who have seen one of the more than couple hundred Zoom presentations that I've done, you'll know that the metaphor that I use to talk about the pandemic is a two-headed monster, right? The first head of the monster is the COVID-19 pandemic, the public health crisis. The second head of the monster is the fiscal crisis, or the economic downturn. Well, it occurred to me over the summer of 2020 that this darn monster, it grew a third head. And the third head of the monster is the mental health crisis. The mental health crisis that we're dealing with in our schools. And long after the public health crisis and the fiscal crisis fades from our view, the public health crisis will remain. And the strategy that people are using to address this today is social emotional learning. Now, while social emotional learning has been around for more than two decades, it's emerged as a priority in education as our school leaders have confronted the ever increasing issues regarding mental health for our students. The alarming rise in mental health issues have been triggered for our students by social media shaming, by ghosting, by peer pressure, by bullying, by the increase in suicides, even in our middle schools, and yes, school shootings. These have combined to create the mental health crisis in our schools, and all of this was happening before the pandemic. Since the pandemic, our students have been dealing with things like all of the missed events in their lives, like graduations and proms and concerts and travel and socializing with their friends. They've had to confront the social justice issues, come to grips with unsure about their direction in life for their career, and unable to find a clear pathway to their own passion in life. And if you doubt for a moment the severity of this crisis, all we need to do is look at the report that was released just last week by the Surgeon General of the United States, raising this as a four-alarm fire. And the thing that has emerged as a priority in dealing with this, it has moved social-emotional learning front and center as the confluence of the COVID-19 pandemic and the student health issues, mental health issues, have converged. And we are in a unique position as music educators to do something about it. Because the question's not if a music practice will impact a social emotional competency, but how it will impact and what we can do as music educators to improve the odds that that impact will be positive. That impact will be positive, not if, but how. And that's what we're here to talk about today, and that's why we've established this all-star panel that we've assembled for you of some of the icons of contemporary composing in our field today. And I can think of no better person to help us lead the conversation than my good friend and colleague and our national voice for social emotional learning and music education, Dr. Scott Engel.
My friends, thank you so much. Today is not about telling you what is SEL. There's enough webinars out there that Bob and I have done that we're gonna give you those resources you can do that on your own. Today is about translation. Today is about figuring out how you do this in your band and orchestra classrooms at all levels. So we're just gonna jump into understanding very broadly that there are three big categories of social and emotional learning that we need to help our students understand if we're gonna confront this mental health crisis. The first is identity, that our students need to understand who they are. They need to understand their background, their demographic. How does that play into the decisions and beliefs that they make? And once they understand that, we need to translate that for music education. You know, if anyone has ever sight read a piece perfectly right off the bat, you know it's too easy. In music, we have to encounter challenge. We have to encounter difficulty. And as we learn to fight through the musical process, we learn to fight through the challenges of life. Musical creation. I can't hide from music. My strengths are evident. My needs are evident. I can't hide. We as directors can help our students understand that we don't all need to be perfect, that we need to be honest with ourselves. And music is that litmus test. And then probably the most important thing that we can help our students do is to set their own goals. How often do they jump through our hoops, jump over our bars? As opposed to when students can authentically say, this is my goal. And then, authentic, accurate self-perception. Can they self-assess instead of it just being a grade that we give them? So once we understand who our students are, well, then we can progress to how do we fit into the bigger picture? Belonging. Are our spaces safe? You know that no quality music happens without a safe space. Music mandates vulnerability. Music mandates trust. If we don't have it, we don't have music. Relationships are at the heartbeat of music education, not the music. Celebrate cultural assets. I am not the best at anything. There are people in this room who are so much better. Our skill sets complement each other. What Jim does, what Brian does, what Omar does, they have an authentic compositional voice. And when you put them together, they are stronger. That's why we have concerts and not just one piece. We think thoughtfully about how our music comes together. And then vulnerability. It takes vulnerability to say, I'm not the best, because guess what, folks? Your musical strengths, my musical strengths, are typically our ensemble's musical strengths. Our musical weaknesses, guess what? Our ensemble's musical weaknesses. That takes vulnerability to own up to that one. And then finally, agency. And this is tough, because this means that we can't take up all the air in the room, that we need to embrace the diversity that's in front of us and say that our students' voices matter, and our students need to be able to affect meaningful change in our classrooms, in our schools, and in our communities. Amplified student voice. But it needs to be three things to realize this. The first thing is it needs to be embedded. It should never feel like it is music, 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 stop, SEL. Music, 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 music. You know what I'm talking about. It needs to be intentional. We as educators need to go in and say that the life skills that we foster in music education are just as important as the musical skills, if not more so. Now, does this mean that we go into the room and write SEL on the board? No, that's not gonna do well, is it? We know that it needs to be embedded to a point and intentional from our perspective. And then it needs to be sustained. One of the questions I get, friends, is how many minutes should I spend on SEL? Here's the blunt answer, all of them. All of your minutes need to be SEL, and all of your minutes need to be music. So that brings us to a space that we're gonna start with that music. And the three folks who we are just so fortunate to have with us today to talk about their music, and three folks who have contributed in meaningful ways that will show you some videos that they've submitted, give us a tangible play to be intentional, embedded, and sustained when we start to think about helping our students build their identity, belonging, and agency. So with that, we're gonna kick things off with our dear friend, Alex Shapiro, who unfortunately was unable to be here with us today, but she submitted a great video. We give you Alex.
Hey everybody, I am so disappointed that I can't be there physically with you all to vibrate and be excited about social emotional learning together in the room. But it just means the Starbucks line is one person shorter for the rest of you, so that's a good thing. I want to take just a few minutes to walk you through some slides that give you examples of what social emotional learning means to me and how I apply it throughout my life, daily life as a composer. Okay, here we go. So here's what social emotional learning means to me. Social, tribal, collaborative, empathetic. Music making is each of these things. Emotional, community-based, expressiveness. Music making is each of these things. And learning. This is what happens all the more readily when we engage a student in a way that values them as an individual who is worthy and from a perspective of their contributions being interconnected with the contributions of others. I think it's fantastic that Scott and Bob bring composers directly into the line of responsibility and possibility when it comes to SEL. I've long believed that composers writing in any genre and writing for even the most virtuosic and professional of players and ensembles should also be creating pieces for students, some of whom may end up performing our professional work, but all of whom will become part of the fabric of our society. I want to quickly show you two pieces that give students a connection to the larger world around them, focusing on two important SEL principles, empathy and agency. In a piece titled Beneath, students can develop empathy with the fragile creatures in the sea as they perform with a very special soloist, a humpback whale, which you can hear in the background. I also sought to give them a sense of agency and ownership by including built-in opportunities for them to improvise. They don't get a chance to do that a whole lot, right? I incorporated my nature photos and my videos into the delivery web pages for the downloadable score and parts and audio tracks, so I can instantly pull others into a different world that sets the tone for the music they're about to delve into. And for the performance, I love to incorporate visuals that immerse the audience as well. I used a piece for younger students titled Rock Music to inspire empathy and affinity for the very planet on which they walk. I asked them to go outside, find two rocks, and make a recording of them being hit or scraped, which I then incorporated into the audio track. That gave the students agency and the experience of contributing to something that will be played around the world. Additionally, the band director, Chris Gleason, invited a geologist to give a talk to the students right there in the band room. The students made video reports that paired their newfound knowledge of local geology with their individual recipes for eliciting sounds from rocks, and one of them made a really powerful video that accompanied the performance. In both of these pieces, the ensemble director has the opportunity to broaden the conversation beyond the notes on the page and even bring in other teachers to discuss topics like environmentalism. And I wanted to show you these two pieces as examples of the power that composers have to broaden the sense of the world for students as well as their audiences. Thanks for listening, and I hope you've all had a really safe and incredibly fabulous Midwest so far. Bye.
Absolutely, Alex hits it out of the park. We're going to send things over to Brian now, who's going to talk about some of his pieces.
I don't want to follow that.
Jeez. So there's two images up there, and one of them is, I guess I'll go in the reverse order. So the first one, some of you may have been at the Fairfax Wind Symphony concert last night, and they performed Stages, which is dedicated to Kelsey. Kelsey had asked, she had stage 4 colon cancer, and she had heard Love and Light, which is of course the other representation there with me and Elizabeth Elliott, who's here. I'll ask her to stand in a minute. And Chelsea said, you know, I heard that piece that you wrote for her, and I need a piece to help me on my cancer journey. And where I'm going with this is not that we write pieces for these awful things, but my mindset, and this has really transformed the way I approach music, both as a composer and as a conductor. And the idea being that when she first asked me to do it, I thought to myself, oh geez, I just had done Love and Light. It's just too much. It's too much. Like I can't go through all that again. And then I thought, Brian, you're talking to somebody with stage 4 cancer. Who are you to say it's too much? And it kind of reminded me that if I can use my music, whether I'm a conductor, an educator, a composer, if I can use my music to help somebody, whether it's in a dark place or in a place of light, if I can use the music to do that, why wouldn't I do that, right? I had told Amy Birdsong at JMU after we had done that premiere, I said, you know, I feel like I joked around, but I wasn't joking, but I feel lately like the death composer, right? That's what I feel like. I feel like, I mean, that's Kelsey's, that's an image of the headstone. And that's the hope theme from Love and Light, and that it touched them that much. And she said to me, she said, no, you're not bad at all. She said, you're giving these people life. Mm. And it made me think about everything that all of us are going through right now, whether it's the kids, whether it's us. And I think for the longest time, we've all been thinking about like, okay, I've got to get these kids to grade 3. I've got to get them to grade 4. I want to go in at grade 5 this year. Or my kids, their scales, they're not fast enough. And the thing that's always worried me is that I think when we all came back from the pandemic, I think we all celebrated. It was the most beautiful thing because suddenly we were celebrating a tuning note. We were celebrating the first read through, which sounded, what's a good word, terrible. But we celebrated it, and here's the thing, right? Something odd happened. The clarinet player squeaked, right? And all the kids kind of laughed, and for a moment everything was normal again. For that one moment, we're all laughing, we're joking, kids are joking around in the band room. Get your instruments out, guys, we gotta get started, right? And suddenly everything felt normal again. And why I think this clinic is so important, because I feel like we're at this crossroads right now. We all want to get back to normal, and I'm right there with you, but not if normal means that we stop celebrating all of that stuff, right? Celebrating every single little thing. And so that's kind of why I mentioned these two pieces, right? Stages last night, after the performance, it was overwhelming. But so many people coming up saying, here's my story. You know, thank you for helping me or my father or my mother and all of those things. And it was overwhelming. And then Elizabeth, where are you, Elizabeth? Where are you? Aww. There you are. Yay. And so, you know, when Elizabeth went through this, stillbirth with her daughter Madison, and we went through this journey together. And you had just kind of mentioned the point. Here, you tell them. Let me do it. The whole point of the piece, right? But it wasn't to. It was for Madison, obviously. But it was much bigger, and it's the emotional reason that just a quick thing.
Hi. Good morning.
By the way, can you speak?
Yes.
Okay, good.
Hi, I'm Elizabeth Elliott. Yeah, I reached out to Brian and I needed a piece of music to help me through a really hard moment. My husband's here too, Scott. We lost our daughter, Madison, in childbirth, and Brian was the right person for that job. And really, I look back on that year, it was a year-long journey writing this piece. And he was my music therapist for a year. I mean, right after everything happened, I was in a state of turmoil and grief and darkness, and what I wanted in the piece was completely different than what I wanted a year later when we were magically pregnant with our son, who's now almost 2, and we needed that light and hope, and you know, to know that our daughter's in a safe place with all the other babies. And what we realized is this is something that touches every fabric of society, not just bands, and I was in the military, not just military, but everybody. And we realized that the scope of the piece was going to be very far reaching. And it's going to touch students that are in your ensembles that aren't even old enough to really understand stillbirth, miscarriage, infant loss, but knowing that it's 1 in 4 who experience that, and it will touch someone in your ensemble someday, and this piece of music will be there to help them through it, whether you play it or whether you just share it with them. It's a very special addition to the repertoire, Brian.
Thank you. So I want to pass it down, and I don't know who we're going to next, but we'll do that. But I think the thing to take from it is that these pieces heal. And if it can heal in those kinds of events, imagine mental health-wise what we can do when we approach it that way, right? Yeah.
Let's hear from Brian. Unfortunately, our dear friend Kate Nishimura is unable to be here, but she has submitted a video as well.
As a student, music education provided opportunities for me to feel empowered and connected. The music room was my safe space and the place where I developed many of the life skills that I rely on regularly today. Some of those include communication, confidence and independence, leadership, teamwork and collaboration, empathy and respect, and of course, imagination. As a composer, I am always thinking about what learning opportunities I can present through my music and making sure that students are getting what they need from the music in front of them. Educators can use my music as entry points to exploring topics such as environmentalism, social justice, mental health, and more. Here are a couple of examples of my music with connections to social emotional learning. Wilderness is a grade 4 band piece that celebrates and honors Earth's remaining wild spaces and the people who fight to protect them. The piece is a call to action for all of us to examine our relationships with the natural world, to do our part in spreading awareness about climate change, and to deepen our respect for the stewards of the land. When I was a child and I started learning about the negative impacts of human activity on the natural world, I felt very sad and powerless. Music became one of the ways I could express my emotional responses to things like this. Now that I know how much we can all do to make an impact, I feel passionate about empowering others to learn and adapt and be part of the solution. Educators can use this piece as an entry point to having discussions about climate change and how young people are feeling about their future. Here are just a few actions that could enrich the experience of working on this piece. Develop a relationship with local Indigenous communities. Get involved with conservation projects like neighborhood cleanups or a tree planting. Take a field trip to a local park and go on a guided hike with a nature-based educator. Ask students to create art projects to be presented in a video at the concert or displayed throughout the school. In my experience, one of the best ways to get people to care about an important cause like this is to establish an emotional connection with the cause. And I think that music is one of the most effective ways to do this. When it comes to destigmatizing mental health, one of the biggest barriers is knowing how to talk about how we feel. Music is an excellent tool to develop the emotional vocabulary for students to communicate about how they're feeling and what their needs are. My piece, Tundra, is a musical window into my experience living with depression. This piece was very difficult for me to write, and I had to be vulnerable and brave when sharing it publicly. The original instrumentation is euphonium and piano, but one of my upcoming projects is to create a version for soloist and wind ensemble so that the message behind the music can be spread even further. Here are some SEL connections with this piece. Listen to the piece with the students and encourage written or spoken reflections on students' own connections with the emotional content of the music. Talk about how to create and maintain a safe space in the music room or the school community at large. Brainstorm as a class some of the emotions that I, as the composer, might have felt while sharing such a personal story through music. Sometimes it can be challenging and even uncomfortable to talk about these topics, but I think music can provide a safe context to begin to explore them. In closing, I just want to say thank you to all music teachers for being some of the unseen superheroes of this world, especially during the last 2 years. One of the best things that my music teachers did for me was being supportive of my curiosity. And this is something you can do for your students as well. Providing a safe space for students and leading by example when it comes to well-being and self-awareness are some of the best ways to make a lasting impact.
We're going to pass it to Jim Stevenson.
Thank you. I feel like I should just say I echo what everybody else has already been saying, and I'll put my own little spin on it. But I love this photo that we brought up because that's my mom and dad. And that's me when I was about 10 years old at the National Music Camp at Interlochen. And Interlochen, and I'm going to talk about why this photo is important to me, but Interlochen was the place where, as a young trumpet player, I found my community, right? This is what the band room does for all of us. This is what music, I mean, I went from public high school where some kids might have thought trumpet was interesting choice for something fun, and then I go there and I found my people, right? We could talk about music all day and just jazz out about it. And for the next 28 years, I was playing in orchestras. That was my career. And playing all this music that other composers had written, and I watched my colleagues, you know, bopping their heads or just getting ready for a solo and enjoying the music and putting their legs out and clapping for each other after they played a solo. And then when I became a composer, that's the kind of music I wanted to write. I wanted to write music that would help form that sense of community in all the ensembles that were playing. And I literally want people to lean in and play pieces together and pat each other on the back afterward and just and create that space, that safe space that we've already talked about. Secondly, that photo that has my mother in it, 5 years ago I had my second symphony premiere here at Midwest Clinic, and at that time I didn't tell people what the piece was about. And when the Marine Band had asked me to write that piece, they said, Jim, you can write whatever you want. And when it came time to write that piece, whatever I wanted, my mother had just passed away. And Brian talked about music being healing, right? And in my case, it was a way to heal myself. I literally sat at the piano and hit this loud low E flat and hit like a screaming out chord. My fingers just went wherever they went on the piano, and it was literally me screaming out to the world, like, how am I going to get through this emotional event that's just occurred in my life? And so my goal was then to write this piece that starts at E flat and gets to E flat at the end only when I feel like I've made this journey. Like, it's not going to be done until I've found a way to get through this emotional turmoil. And I include a voice in it, which is that of my mother, singing, but I didn't tell anybody that because we Stevensons were kind of, we keep stuff close, right? We don't want to, I want people to like the music for what it is. I don't really want to share the backstory, and I want you to like for what it is. However, about a year later after the performance, I was having dinner with Colonel Fettig of the Marine Band, and I said, Jason, I want to tell you what that piece was actually about. And so I shared with him that it wasn't just a symphony, it was actually about this crisis of the death of my mother. And he said, Jim, you have to share that with people. And it was at that point that I started going out and being vulnerable and telling people what it was actually about, whether I was conducting it or in the audience or telling people privately. And my world changed at that point. People started, as you were saying, people started coming up and saying, oh my gosh, I have a story. It's not about the death of my mother, but I've had this hurting thing going on, and your piece helped so much. And then you start hugging people and you start sharing these community of, you know, we all are in this community together. And it changed my life. And so as a composer, I mean, we all do this. We all are putting those into the notes of our music. And so we go halfway, and when the directors and musicians meet us the other half, and they explain what the composers are doing, and they explain what the intent is, and what the composers themselves are going through, that's when we form this community and that safe space that we can all exist in and share, and it grows and grows and grows and grows. So I know my story is a little different, that I had to write this piece for myself, but it allowed me to be vulnerable, and I think that's a really important thing to recognize for all composers of all ages and all people of all time, that when we share these emotions, that's when we all get closer and have richer experiences. Thank you.
We now have a short video from Richard Saucedo.
Hi everyone, I'm Richard Saucedo and I apologize for not being there in person today, but nevertheless I am very excited to be a part of this very special clinic, Embedding SEL into Instrumental Music. I think this is such an important topic right now and I'm just so glad to be a part of it. I want to thank Scott Edgar, I want to thank Bob Morrison and all the wonderful composers for doing this and being a part of this and for allowing me to be a small part of it. The piece you heard at the opening of the video was a piece called Walking Into History that I was commissioned to write by the Eastern Tennessee Band and Orchestra Directors Association. The piece was written to commemorate the Clinton 12, a group of black students who were forced because of the desegregation rules in Tennessee to attend an all-white high school called Clinton High School. On any given day, the Clinton 12, those students, would walk from a place called Foley Hill down the street to Clinton High School. What they met along the way was not pleasant. Many times they were accompanied by ministers, people trying to protect them. There was a minister at one point that was trying to protect them who was severely beaten as the kids were walking. So it was a very, very tough time for all involved. But the good news about this story is one of the mornings that the students walked to Clinton High, rumor has it, and I think it's a pretty strong rumor, that the band from Clinton High was out there to greet them, showing even back then that music could bring people together. And it is my hope that this piece will be used in your classroom or others, or pieces like it will be used to promote the fact that music is different than the rest of the world. Music is about all people. Music is about all cultures. Music is about emotion. But it's emotion from the heart, and it's emotion that can be enjoyed by anyone, anywhere in the world. So as I said, it is my hope that this piece will help you to get your students to understand that what's going on today in our society, no matter it be good or bad, was probably going on back then in the 50s. And what the Clinton 12 experienced in the 50s is very similar to what many of our folks today are feeling. Thanks for listening, and I'm going to end this segment with the very end of the piece. You'll hear three bars where there are 12 different notes, a note for each member of the Clinton 12. Thank you.
We'll be right back.
Could you still say that? And our final composer on the panel, Omar Thomas.
Good morning, everyone. Isn't that like the cutest thing ever?
Yeah.
So that's me, 2.5 years old in Brooklyn, New York, where I'm originally from, on Bedford Avenue. And this is me with two carnival dancers during the annual Caribbean Carnival Parade that happened every year down Eastern Parkway. So the reason that I'm showing this piece is for several. One of them is the piece that's being premiered tonight by Vinegar High School, is rooted in this music and in this cultural language. And this is the earliest music that I remember experiencing in my life. And I have a feeling that it might be very unfamiliar to most of the folks in the room. I don't know what experience you have with soca and calypso music from the Caribbean, but these are my earliest sounds. And so this is just native to who I am. And it's been a part of my journey from when I started picking up the trombone and playing in your ensembles all the way through elementary, middle, and high school and college. This music has always been a part of who I am. It exists anytime our family gets together for barbecues and for holidays and for repasts when one of our family members transitions to ancestry. You know, we get together at the house of that person for several nights and have big meals, and we celebrate with joyful music. We celebrate their transition. So that is one of the reasons that I wanted to present you with this. The other reason is because my introduction to this wind ensemble world as a composer is not through joyful music. My first big piece that many of you have played, and I'm so honored and thankful for that, is a piece called Of Our New Day Begun, which was commissioned to commemorate the Charleston Nine who lost their lives in a white supremacist terrorist shooting on June 17, 2015. And it's a piece that I did not want to write at all. It was my first, my first wind ensemble piece, and it just felt like a Herculean task. I got a phone call from Dr. Gary Shalit, Western Kentucky University, that his group was just selected to perform at CBDNA Regional that year, and which was in Charleston, South Carolina at the Gilliard Center. And any of you familiar with the geography of Charleston, you know that the Gilliard Center is catty corner from Charleston, a Mother Emanuel church. And he said, we cannot be in that space making music without honoring these lives. And so, you know, he told me that he wanted to invite members of the church to the premiere. And I'm kind of listening with the phone here because every word is just like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And in my mind, I'm saying that I'm gonna say, I'll think about it and kind of not think about it at all. So I hung up the phone and called my dad, and my dad said, call him back right now, and said yes. So I called him back and I said yes, and you know, that was actually the hardest part about writing this piece. I knew that I needed to use the Black National Anthem, Lift Every Voice and Sing, as the cornerstone of that piece. And I knew that it would be an educational experience. I grew up, the first school that I attended in Brooklyn was a private Muslim academy called Al-Karim. And at every assembly, every day in the morning, we would sing the national anthem with which all of you are familiar, and we would sing Lift Your Voice and Sing. So I've known that song my entire life, and I still travel to many places where people don't know that the Black National Anthem exists, even though it's been around for over a century. So I wrote that piece. You all have received it so warmly. But I made a decision in that moment that I did not want to be known as a Black trauma composer. And I spent a lot of time thinking about how I wanted to show up in this world, our field. And I came to the realization that, first of all, Black music is very underrepresented in concert music in general. And paradoxically, we are overrepresented in music that speaks to Black trauma. And I did not want to continue to create works that just kind of was pornographic about Black pain. And so I've been on a mission to kind of kick pebbles into this chasm of music that's rooted in Black joy. And so a number of the pieces that have come after are celebrations of all the things that go into the gift of who we are, besides our pain and our trauma. So this piece that's going to be premiered tonight, I can think of no more joyful expression than the piece about Caribbean Carnival, where there are costumes and there's food and there are people dancing in the street, waving their flags in unison to the beat. And what's really beautiful about that is that I feel like anywhere else in the country, if you see a number of flags waving, by and large, it's all the same flag. It's our flag. But the Caribbean nations think of ourselves as one nation, one Caribbean nation. And so all these beautiful, bright flags go up in unison to the beat behind these 18-wheeler kind of flatbed trucks with these giant towers of speakers, and it's just a giant party. And I did it, you know, when I was asked to do this commission, and Kevin Sedetal said, it's gotta be joyful and festive. I said, I'm gonna figure this out. And this piece, I'll be honest with you, it almost broke me. I didn't have a model for this. I didn't know how to take a music that was kind of a 1-4-5 dance music and turn it into a 7.5 minute concert experience. I didn't know how to go about complicating it for the sets of your sensibilities. Does that make sense? You know, without selling out my people, basically. So that was such a struggle. Lots of tears, lots of banging my head on the piano. But just to kind of get your ears and your souls into this, I think I sent, did I send a link to you? I sent the link? No, there was a lot, there was a link. Anyway, but I'll tell you this, on the second page of the score, I have recommended listenings. So that if you are so kind to program this music with your individual ensembles, that you have a starting place, okay? Because this is a new language, and how do we learn languages? We don't learn languages off a page. We learn by listening and imitating and internalizing and repeating. And so that is my hope with kind of all of the music that I create that comes from a different language, that you take the time to familiarize yourself with that language, and you've got a whole ensemble of students as well with whom you can share that task. And it's really an entryway into who I am, but it's not just about me, into who we are in general. And if there's anything that I want students to take away from my work, maybe there are other composers who don't feel like who they are has space within the four walls of music academia. So I was given kind of unofficial, tangential permission from other composers who wrote music that I didn't even know was possible. It just wasn't in any part of my field of vision. And I'm hoping that young composers who hear my music but don't hear themselves on the stage anywhere can say, wait, why not? Let's give it a try and see what happens. So this piece is a celebration of who I am and who we are, and I encourage you all to come to the concert tonight. Shameless plug, Vanderbilt at 5:30. Thank you.
So now, friends, for the special part of this. This is when we just get to talk. This is just when we get to play off with each other and understand what's in our heart. We heard so many powerful things. We heard so many people talk about diverse emotions. You know, I think oftentimes we think right now it's about trauma. It's about our panic that we're feeling. It's about recovery. Omar's words are just resonating in my head that we need to have a robust emotional vocabulary for our students to realize it's good to be back, and we can celebrate that too. So I want to kick things off actually putting a question to Brian, because there's some things that I'm sure there's some wonderful middle school directors in our presence right now, and you're thinking, not pulling off some of the pieces that we're talking about right now. And sometimes I think that leads us to think, well, does that mean that I can't do SEL with a younger group? And Brian, I know that you have some really strong thoughts about this.
Yeah, I do. I mean, I'll be very brief, but I think, first of all, people are like, oh, my kids are not ready to play with that emotion. Rumor has it that middle school kids have emotions. I mean, they're a hot mess, right? And so I think what we need to be doing, though, and where we sometimes miss the boat, I think we don't think about finding a piece that emotionally is available to them, right? I remember during 9/11, somebody sent me a piece, and there was I got all these pieces about all these different things, but there's like several pieces that I got
that was about the tragedy of the buildings going down, and it was for like grade one band. And I just thought, these kids can't grasp that, right? But then there's a piece a lot of you know, like Colliding Visions, right? Which is about an elementary school program that won this great award, and then suddenly found that they've lost funding and the program got cut. So that became the last piece that program ever played. Congratulations, you won an award. Now you're gone. Okay. And so I think it's really important that we realize that middle school kids can feel, right? But we don't always do the best job of finding a piece that allows them to access the emotions that they are capable of accessing.
So powerful, and it really gets to finding the right piece that's going to resonate. Jim Omar, any other thoughts to add to that?
Well, I mean, a lot of times when I go back to my own experience, and I just remember. Yes, I've had children of my own, so I also know that middle school is a fun time. But I remember being in middle school myself, and it was particular teachers who would come up and just say something that made me believe that, just gave me confidence in what I was doing. And I can, if we had time, I would name every single one of those because they just meant so much to me. And so I think just that personal connection, again, I keep saying the word community, but just that reaching out and making sure we all feel like we belong, because we all do, right? And so I applaud everyone here who's always doing that, and that's wonderful.
For a number of years, for 10 years, I taught at Berklee College of Music, and I taught the Intro to Music Education course. And in developing this course, I had this realization that if you watch small children, they are kind of blissfully unaware of the world around them. They like, they'll take a bite of something delicious and spin around for 10 seconds because they're just happy that they have like a chicken nugget in their mouth. And then, you go through kind of elementary, and then you get this really sad moment where there's this self-awareness that happens, and all of a sudden, they are aware of how other people look at them and that they have opinions of them, and then all of that magic kind of starts to dim. What we try to do as creative people, and it's the saddest thing, because if that door closes all the way, you spend your whole life trying to get back to that, because that's where all your creativity lives, And so you get to about middle school, and what I think is beautiful about what you all do as educators is that you wedge your foot in the door so it doesn't shut completely all the way. And you let a little bit of light in, so that creativity can always live and burst forth, and you help these students pry that door back open. That's what we mean by a safe space and the importance of what it is that you do. So these works about whatever, as long as they speak to the totality of our emotional range, use it, okay? All of those can be opposite forces that helps to pry that door open so that we always have access to this emotional creativity that fuels what we do and what we believe in so much. So thank you for what you do, and just work with them to make sure that door doesn't close all the way.
So powerful. As someone who conducts an ensemble myself, I know that I do a lot more conscious, embedded SEL at the beginning of a concert cycle, and then the week before the concert, it gets down to notes and rhythms, right? Because there's a concert. I want to talk about this idea about embedded, but also this idea of balance, because I think there's a misnomer in the world of social and emotional learning that it's either SEL connection, emotional embedding, or musical excellence. Thoughts on that?
Frank Kelly actually spoke about this, and there's a lot of people here that I see conductors' wives that do this too, but what we have to remember is that technique exists for one reason and one reason only. Technique exists to serve musicianship. That's why it exists. We learn to play really, really fast so that we can communicate the emotion of panic or excitement or energy. We learn to play really, really slow so we can communicate the emotion of tension or mourning or longing. And as soon as we separate the two, you will get good at what you practice. And if you practice, and I can tell it happens here at Midwest, we practice the notes for 2 months, and then we say, now we're going to start embedding SEL, but they've already gotten good at what they practice, which has nothing to do with SEL,
right? And so I think it's really important that we do remember they're connected. And when I rehearse, everything that I do comes from social emotional learning. It's why are we crescendoing? Don't just tell them to get loud, tell them why. Because there's rage coming here, right? The one thing I want to say about Omar's piece, I talked about this earlier, Mother of Revolution, right? I've conducted that a bunch of times. And then I heard him talk one day about, he's like, you know how you get so angry sometimes you want to bang your fist against the wall? Well, imagine how angry you must be to throw a brick through a window. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, I realized all those crescendos, all those big, like, I was completely doing it wrong, right? Completely doing it wrong. And I kept saying, well, and suddenly I realized why, right? Because you make the connection. You cannot do one and not the other. You just can't.
Sure.
Well, everything you just said, because that's absolutely right. I promise, if you're not practicing SEL from the first downbeat of my piece, you'll never play it correctly. And the reason that I say that is I learned, even before I started writing for Wind Ensemble, I was writing for big band, there's just so much that cannot be notated. Notation is finite. We put so much weight on learning, and I understand why. Learning the notes and the rhythms off the page. But like I just said, if we're learning a new language, do you open the book first or are you listening to how this language goes first, right? My classic example is, you know, a paragraph of French, ask a room full of people, is there anybody here who does not speak French? And give them that paragraph in French to read. It's all characters you recognize, but you will sound completely crazy if you've never heard French, you're trying to read a paragraph in French. Right, and I feel the same way about a lot of the musical language that I use. You have to understand that not all of these accents should be played the same way in every piece. You know, you have to understand if you're looking at the melodic content in the first movement of Come Sunday, there are staccato markings in places that seem very counterintuitive if you only have a European classical lens through which you can view it. In the language of gospel and jazz, it makes 1,000,000% sense. But if you haven't done any of the work to excavate that cultural understanding, then you're not going to understand it. Written music is finite, and it's like every piece that I write, I realize just how much more finite it is, which is why I put a list of recommended listenings in front of the score. You gotta start with the ear, start with the music, or you know, with the sound of the music. Just play along to this. One thing that's really great about this style of music, soca and calypso, is it's very conversational melodies and they're very diatonic. So figure out the key and just learn how to play the melody exactly how the singer is singing it. And then all of a sudden, when you look at those rhythms, they won't be as terrifying. Mm-hmm. You gotta start from that place. You gotta start from the emotional place. And then do the one lolly, two lollies later. Bring those in later.
Yeah.
You know, but you gotta start from here. You gotta start with the emotion of the music.
I guess one just brief thing I would add is that I was recently at a university and I was conducting a piece of mine and there was a flute solo and the flute solo, she literally, you know, we stopped for some reason. She literally said, well, how do you want this to be played? You're the composer. And I said, that's true, and I understand why you're asking, but this is our piece.
Yeah.
We're in this together. I'm gonna walk away from this with a different experience because of the ownership you take in this piece. And so that I go to places and somebody's playing a solo for me and they'll play something, and I'm like, I never thought of it. I mean, I wrote the piece, but I never thought of it going that way. And it literally affects the pieces I write from then on and the experiences I have from then on. And so just encouraging that ownership from each individual is so important that they feel that they have something to contribute. Yeah.
You know that you're in a special place when you don't want it to end. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, we are coming up to that point. But I hope that you have heard identity, belonging, agency, heard and seen the tangible spaces where music can be these entry points. I'm gonna finish it up, handing it back to Bob Morrison.
So just some resources real quick, and then we'll send you on your way. The Teaching Social Emotional Learning Through Music podcast is at Music for All. A lot of great conversations with some of these gentlemen here and lots of other people around the connection between social emotional learning and music education. And in partnership with Save the Music, we have a year-long series, monthly series, on SEL and student transformation. So I encourage you in the resource link to find that information. Scott will be down at the GIA booth this afternoon at some point in time. What time is it?
Right after this.
Right after this, so you can talk to Scott even more. And then we have lots of resources at ArtsEdSEL, the Center for Arts Education and Social Emotional Learning. And again, want to thank all of our sponsors. And before we go, I want to leave you with this quote. This is from Dr. Maurice Elias. He is one of the founding fathers of social emotional learning and character development in the world. And over the past 3 or 4 years that we've been working together, this quote, he says, "I believe everyone will soon come to realize that our music educators are the secret weapon to implementation of social emotional learning in our schools. And I feel increasingly strongly that music and SEL is the next frontier." So we are on the frontier with those superpowers that we have embedded in music. And it's our job and our responsibility to take these gifts that we have and open the aperture so that we can share it with all of our students. So I want to thank all of our composers today. We've got Brian, we've got Kate, we've got Richard.